six games into the octagonal, and Canada sits third. And now we are prepping for two more huge home games this window in Edmonton, Alberta, at the Commonwealth Stadium against Costa Rica and Mexico. Canada is off to a flying start to their first final round of CONCACAF World Cup qualifiers since qualification for the 1998 World Cup, going undefeated through six games, including two crucial away draws against Mexico and the United States. And now we are coming in to the third window of this World Cup qualifying round, going up with just two home games, both in Edmonton against Costa Rica and Mexico. Two absolutely huge matches, as first off, Costa Rica, the last remaining team Canada has not played, is sitting 4 points behind Canada in fifth in the standings for the octagonal. Reminder, the top three teams go straight to the World Cup and the fourth place team goes to an intercontinental playoffs. And Mexico is sitting 4 points above Canada in first place in the octagonal. So two wins here and Canada is not only solidly in a World Cup spot, but also in contention for first place, which would be absolutely insane given our predictions of where we would be coming into this octagonal. Two games, both in Canada, that's huge because it means that we don't have to deal with travel, we don't have to deal with playing two games on the road, flying to multiple different countries, or playing in Canada and then in another country and another country and then in Canada. The Canadian guys get to come to Edmonton at the beginning of the window and they get to stay here for the whole window. That's huge for rest reasons, especially given that the second match in this window is Mexico. And only two matches, which is the same for all CONCACAF teams this window, but only two matches this window means that the depth of Canada is going to be less exposed, but that's not as big of a deal this window as we have a fully healthy team compared to what happened last window. The only player missing really from the full 23-man roster, the fully healthy 23-man roster for Canada right now, is Junior Hoilett. So that's a huge increase after missing Laren, Hutchinson, Hoilett, Borjan, all in the previous October window. So you get two games, a fully healthy lineup. I'd imagine you'd see the same lineup, pretty much the same lineup in both games, as you have a Friday game and then 3 days off and then a Tuesday game. That doesn't mean that we're not going to see the whole squad. As for this window, Canada has what honestly looks like the greatest Canadian roster ever assembled. I know we keep saying that for each of these windows, well, maybe not October, but this time it really is true. A fully healthy lineup. Laren's back. Hutchinson's back. The only exception is Junior Hoilett's missing. Cavallini's back. Alphonso Davies, fully healthy, good to go. Fully healthy squad for Canada, with the exception of Junior Hoilett. Great depth in this Canada squad. And of the 23-man roster, 22 of them are familiar and have been with Canada before, in this World Cup qualifying window. The one exception, the one new guy, is Ike Ugbo, who just this week committed to playing for Canada. Ugbo is a 23-year-old striker who plays for Genk in the Belgian First Division. And he joins the Canadian national team as a former Chelsea Academy player who played for England at youth levels. And he is another one of these guys who's a dual national, a guy who he's born in England, mostly kind of raised in England, also grew up a bit in Canada as well, between I think the ages of like 4 to 5 and then like 10. He went back to the Chelsea Academy as a U10 player and also is of Nigerian descent, so he could also have played for Nigeria. And the fact that he, at the age of 23 now, is coming to commit for Canada, this is huge because Ike Ugbo, okay, maybe he's not a name like Cavallini, like Laren, like David. In terms of strikers, he's probably number 4 on the list now. But the fact that he committed to Canada, because this is the type of player who 5-6 years ago doesn't commit to Canada. Ike Ugbo 5-6 years ago would probably have gone to play for Nigeria if they came calling, or just not played for Canada, stuck around, held out hope for an England call-up. Because 5-6 years ago, why would you come play for Canada? If you don't have a real tight connection with a country that calls you up, if they don't have players who you want to play with, and if they don't have a competitive team, there's no real reason why you would go play for them. So Ike Ugbo, 5-6 years ago, talking 2015, 2016, before Alphonso Davies, he probably doesn't come to play for Canada. And now he has an opportunity to come play for a Canadian team, has an opportunity to potentially qualify for a FIFA World Cup and play in a FIFA World Cup with Canada, can now play with Jonathan David, with Alphonso Davies, with Stephen Eustachio, with high quality players. Canada now has put ourselves into a position where players like Ugbo coming to play for Canada internationally, it's a positive career move for them because now they get experience and show that they can play on a level with players like Alphonso Davies and Jonathan David. And for a guy like Ugbo, that's humongous. So, well, he's not a crucial new piece. It's not like we're bringing in a Jonathan David caliber striker. We're bringing in a depth striker for this team. So the point of him joining Canada now isn't what he brings to Canada. It's so much what he represents, what it means for Canada that he would decide now to come and represent Canada, especially over a Nigeria team, which apparently was interested in him. And also, another striker for Canada is actually quite important, as we saw last window when Larin and Cavallini were both injured, and also, you know, Ayo Akinola is injured as well from TFC. So with those guys all out, we saw a Canada team that behind Jonathan David really didn't have any real options at striker. Charles Andreas Brim, still very young and very raw in terms of talent and development-wise, and he still only plays in the second-tier Dutch league, so not a huge grade-A option. Tesho Akindele has had some playtime at the Gold Cup. You know, solid guy in MLS, but not really a great option behind Jonathan David. So just having another guy who plays in a European league of the caliber of the Belgian league, which, you know, as we all remember, Jonathan David was a Belgian league guy a couple years ago when he came out in 2019 and just destroyed everything for Canada. So just to have another guy in a first division European league, and a decent first division European league at that, who can come in, who's a striker, just the extra depth that that adds is actually huge for Canada, as we saw when we were hurting last window. So overall, this is a very, very, very strong Canadian squad. The best 11 that I'd pick, I'd probably go with the usual 3-5-2 that has been being played for Canada in recent games. Go with Milan Borjan in net, with a back line, keep the Miller, Vittoria, Johnston trio rolling. Those three have been fantastic in the back end for Canada. Kamal Miller and Alistair Johnston, what a year, what a breakout year they've had for Canada, both of those two players, especially in a crucial center back position where Canada has been weak. Midfield, my three center midfielders I'd go with, I'd probably do in Atiba Hutchinson, Marc-Anthony Kay, and Stephen Eustachio. Hutchinson for the experience, Kay and Eustachio both have been just very, very good for Canada recently and are just great cogs to have in the center of midfield. Two wide wing back slash wide midfielder type players. Tejan Boucan on the right. He, huge breakout year. Another guy who's going to the Belgian League at the end of this season in MLS. Has a real solid shot to win MLS Cup with the New England Revolution. Has already won a supporter shield with the New England Revolution. He has to be in the lineup. Left side, we start to have questions. Do we want Richie Larea on the left side and put Alphonso Davies up top? Or when both Larin and David are healthy, do we put Alphonso Davies on that left wing back role and run David and Larin? I think the most top skill Canada team, you put Davies at the left wing back role and then run a David and Larin up front as your two strikers. David sitting back a bit as a number 10 and Larin up as a number 9. I think that's the best way to go. Although Richie Larea has been so good for Canada, I don't really see him being taken out of the starting 11. That's going to be a really interesting decision for John Herdman to make. And in the end, the solution might be more of a 3-4-3, where you move Davies up top with David and Larin, put Larea on the left side, and drop one of Kay or Hutchinson. But I think going up against Mexico especially, I think a midfield 3 is just important, gives you a little more stability in the midfield. So I'd like to see the 3-5-2. However, just with the overload potential of Davies, Larin, David up top, a 3-4-3 isn't entirely out of the question. So score predictions for these two games. First off, Costa Rica versus Canada. This is the must-win match of this window for Canada. Costa Rica at home, a chance to put 7 points between you and Costa Rica, a team that really is pushing for at least intercontinental playoff spot. I think Canada should win this game. They have the talent to win this game at home in Edmonton. They should have the home field advantage as well. I see this game being a 3-1 Canada victory. And then the next game, we have Canada versus Mexico. Coming off of the draw in Mexico, I think there's a belief that Canada actually can win this game, which is absolutely mind-boggling to me. The fact that we're seriously considering about us being able to beat Mexico in a World Cup qualifying match after not having been in the final round of World Cup qualifying for over 20 years. That's just an insane turnaround from the last few years. Going up against Mexico at the Commonwealth Stadium, I'm putting this as a 2-1 Canada game. I think this is it. I honestly do think Canada has a major opportunity to win this match. I think the draw at the Azteca in Mexico was just the starting point, and I think that Canada gets at least a draw out of this match. I think a 2-1 win is entirely possible. It's going to be a hell of a matchup. And if Canada manages to pull those two wins off and come out of this window with 6 points from two games, the World Cup is just at a finger's reach. This might happen, Canada. It's actually getting kind of insane.